Our scripture reading this morning is taken from 2 Timothy chapter 1. 2 Timothy chapter 1, page 995 in the Black Church Bibles. And while you're turning there, can I give you a greeting from Trinity West Church in London and also recognize the honor and the privilege it is for me to be here this morning. I have been significantly influenced by the ministry at 10th Presbyterian Church over many years. Very grateful for the ministries of Dr. Boyce and Dr. Ryken, and Dr. Gallagher has been a mentor and friend to me for almost 20 years, and so it is a huge honor for me this morning to open God's Word with you. 2 Timothy chapter 1, I'm going to begin reading at verse 1. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, according to the promise of the life that is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my beloved child, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God, whom I serve, as did my ancestors, with a clear conscience, as I remember you constantly in my prayers, night and day. As I remember your tears, I long to see you, that I may be filled with joy. I'm reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now, I am sure, dwells in you as well. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power and love and self-control. This is God's word. I had one of those conversations a couple of weeks ago. I wonder if you're familiar with this kind of conversation. For me, given the line of work that I'm in, it often happens when I'm in company and the question comes up, so what do you do? It's certainly a thing in British culture that it kind of happens subconsciously, but in order to place yourself, know where you stand in relation to this person that you've just met, perhaps organize yourself in the pecking order, you ask the question, so what do you do? So it's a common question. And a couple of weeks ago, I was asked that question, and I said, I'm a pastor. And at that point, the tone of the conversation changed. It had been a perfectly nice conversation up to that point, and it took quite a turn from then. The person said they were surprised when I told them that, and I judged by the expression on their face that it wasn't a good surprise. They weren't delighted. They weren't thinking to themselves, you know what, I am so pleased to see you. I've been thinking, if somebody, just somebody, could tell me the Christian hope, could explain it to me, I would be so delighted. No, it wasn't that kind of thing. In fact, the next 10 minutes or so, he went through all of the, so what's your view on this particular hot-button cultural issue? What's your view on this? I don't know, 10, 15 minutes or so of this. And with every answer I offered, he shook his head and disparaged what I said, disparaged my faith, and above all, disparaged me for being so stupid to believe it. Now, when I left the conversation, I was frustrated, of course, but the thing that struck me was I wasn't surprised. I wasn't surprised at all, because this kind of pushback in conversation is something that I've grown to expect. I have conversations in company with people now when I'm introduced to new people, and I expect that when I tell them what I do, when I identify myself as a Christian, that there will be some kind of pushback. Because, like so many cities in the West, and I'm sure Philadelphia is exactly the same, the culture makers are generally hostile to Christianity. That is, those who set the tone of the background noise, if you like, of what people believe in the culture, what people think is okay, what people think is mainstream. Those people, for the most part, in the big cities in the West, are hostile to Christianity. Now, what that has done to Christians is, because we then anticipate that kind of pushback in our conversations, is that we assume the back foot. We're almost, in some cases, apologetic when the issue of what we believe comes up. Can you identify with that? As you go into conversation, perhaps with someone you don't know, perhaps a work colleague, perhaps someone that you meet in the course of everyday life, when the issue of your Christian faith comes to the fore, you adopt the back foot. and adopt a sort of apologetic stance in the way that you engage, by which I mean you sort of apologize for your faith, not that you do a kind of cultivated apologetic engagement with their worldview or anything like that. You get what I mean. Now, in some cases, we just say nothing. We go quiet. We don't own up because we fear the consequences that might follow. We could be passed over for promotion. We could be fired altogether. We could be squeezed out socially. Or perhaps the thing that I find hardest, if I'm honest, the thing that I find most difficult to contend with is when people just kind of give me that patronizing smile and sort of shake their head. That sense of pity. Poor, deluded fool. Maybe it's just I don't want to be thought of as a poor, deluded fool, and so that's what really gets me when this happens. Now, what then comes from that is that there's a fear that one of those responses might happen. There's a fear that it's going to go badly for us, and that fear causes us to step back from what the Bible says. Not to identify with those who say these things. We do have some cultural voices that speak up for the Christian faith. And increasingly, certainly in the UK where I am, as what is consistent with the Bible is explained, the culture is increasingly shrill and hostile and critical. You don't believe that, do you? And the temptation is to say, oh, no, of course not. So we step back from what the Bible says, we step back from those who say it, because we don't like rejection. We want people to love us. We want people not to pity us, but to respect us. And inevitably, we take the easier path, and it's the path of compromise. And then if this creeps up further into the level of church leadership, we really have a big problem. When churches, when the assemblies of the people of God, where the Word of God is supposed to be opened and declared to God's people and to the world, when those contexts step back from what the Bible says. When churches don't teach what it says because of what it might sound like in the culture, we don't want to say that because we don't want the culture to think badly of us. When cultural pressure silences the pulpit, the church has lost its distinctive voice and will quickly look just like the world. So, what we have is a hostile culture that creates fearful Christians and worldly churches. And this is happening all over the United Kingdom where I'm from. And from what I can see and what I know of this side of the pond, it is increasingly the case here as well. The cultural ground is shifting, perhaps quicker than it ever has. So the question is, what are we to do when that's the case? What are we to do as the people of God, as the Church of Jesus Christ in our day, when the cultural heat against us is being turned up day by day? Well, the Apostle Paul says in his second letter to Timothy, this letter gives us some instruction in how to respond. Now, I know that if you come in the evenings, that over the last while you've been working through this letter, so some of this initial information may be familiar to you. But it's one of those things. This letter is giving us instruction for how to live as the church in a hostile culture. And on the one hand, that might not seem immediately obvious. It is a letter from an older pastor, the Apostle Paul, to his young protege, his younger son in the faith, Timothy, verse 2, my beloved child. It's Paul's last letter. He's in prison. Verse 16, chapter 1 tells us that, referring to his chains. He's probably in Rome. Timothy is probably in Ephesus. 1 Timothy 1 talks about him being in Ephesus, and there's no reason to doubt otherwise. Ephesus is a very cosmopolitan, very worldly, very, advancing, culturally advancing kind of city. And so it's a context very much like ours. And Paul is writing in order to provide a pattern for what gospel ministry should look like after the apostolic era. The apostles had a unique role in church history, and they're beginning to die. They're beginning to come to the end of their lives, and Paul sees his own end. Chapter 4, verse 6, he talks about his departure. He gives that great declaration that he's fought the good fight, he's finished the race, he's kept the faith. He knows that his end is coming. And so what he's trying to do is prepare this young prodigy to carry the baton forward. He's not passing on his apostleship, but what he's doing is laying down the key elements of what true gospel ministry should be shaped by and look like and implemented by Timothy as he goes forward. In a culture that is hostile to the gospel, as cosmopolitan Ephesus was, where professing Christians are showing themselves to be ashamed of the Lord. Verse 8, just after our reading, ashamed of the Lord and his servant Paul. Where leaders, chapter 1, verse 15, Phygellus and Hermogenes. Chapter 2, verse 18, Hymenaeus and Philetus, where they are swerving from the truth. When the cultural pressure that is getting up into church leadership and these leaders are wandering away into myths and all kinds of nonsense. Here, Timothy, says Paul, is a pattern for faithful ministry in fearful times. And the reason why we, all of us, need to hear this is so that when we look around in our day and we think to ourselves, the culture has shifted. It's not like it was for us before. People don't accept me. There's no kudos now in me identifying as a Christian. There's certainly no cultural benefit for me if I identify as a Christian. What's going on? Oh, no. When we feel that temptation, Paul gives us perspective. When we look around and we say, you know, that church down the road that soft pedals the Bible, it's growing and growing. Things are going well there. Maybe they're right and we're wrong. Paul provides perspective. And I want us to see in our passage this morning that he starts with encouragement. He encourages Timothy with great affection, and he reminds him of three realities that should encourage him as he looks forward into these days ahead that look like they're going to be so difficult for the sake of the gospel and for the future of the church. And I hope wherever you find yourself this morning, whether you're struggling particularly because you're a Christian, simply because you name the name of Christ, it's a struggle, or you are pursuing leadership in the church, or you're just plodding on in the Christian life, I hope these things will encourage you as well. So, point number one, first of all, Paul reminds Timothy of Christ's gospel, Look at verse 1. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God according to the promise of the life that is in Christ Jesus. That phrase from the pen of a man who is staring his own death in the face and who will later call Timothy and all who will follow Christ to endure persecution, and inevitably that enduring of persecution will mean death for some. As he takes up his pen, he begins what he's going to say with the theme of life. Paul's apostleship was governed by this theme, the promise of life that is in Christ Jesus. It controlled the way he thought about everything because this is the heart of what God is doing in the world. You remember the Bible story begins with God giving life to humanity. He gathered some dust and he breathed into it the breath of life, and Adam was created and then Eve, and they had full and free access to God in the garden, and at the center of the garden was what? The tree of life. They were given a whole garden of life-giving things to enjoy with one restriction. Go and enjoy life in all of its fullness. That tree there, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you're not ready for that yet. Don't touch that one. Do not eat the fruit of that one. In fact, if you do, if you reject what I'm saying, if you set yourself up against me and ignore what I'm saying, the inevitable consequence of that will be death. If you set yourself up as a rival to God, he says, you will die. And we know what happened. They chose to reject God. And so true to his word, death came into the world. Death is, you know, don't you, that death is the outcome of rebellion against God. That is why it exists. We hate it. We know at the very depth, deepest parts of our being, that death is wrong. It doesn't fit in the world that God made to be all about life. You know, don't you, that death is not just a biological thing. It is not just when the brain stops functioning and the heart stops beating. Death is a moral thing. Death hangs over all of us as a curse because of our rebellion against God. And whether we try, however we try to pretend that it's not that bad, when we say things about that someone has died and we say, oh, they've passed to the other room, or we say, you know, they're with the angels now. Oh, Auntie Marjorie, she's looking down on us now, and I'm sure she's having a great old laugh. When we try and cover the horror of death with that sort of sentimentalism that is so prevalent in our culture, whatever version of that story we promulgate or we try to believe ourselves, the truth is we can't avoid it, that death is a horrible intruder into God's good world. But it is an intruder that we open the door to in our rejection of God. And yet God didn't simply eradicate us at that point. He didn't eradicate all life at that rebellion. In fact, he implemented a rescue plan. Adam and Eve were put out of the garden. They were sent away from the tree of life, away from the immediate presence of God. But God then gave a promise to Abraham that despite this rebellion, he would gather and he would save a people for himself, a people so numerous that if you looked at the night sky and tried to count the stars, they would outnumber them. Numerous, more numerous than the grains of sand on the seashore. There will be, according to the promise of God, a people who experience life in relationship with the living God. And through the history of the Old Testament, all the way back, that promise is made, and through the history of the Old Testament, we're looking and we're peering ahead and we're waiting, and yet we see these lovely glimpses of what this will look like. Abraham, he's willing to offer up Isaac. Why? Because Hebrews 11 tells us he reasons that God could raise the dead. Psalm 23, the king can say that though he walks through the valley of the shadow of death, he fears no evil. Why? He doesn't fear death because we read to the end of the psalm, subsequently he will live and he will reign forever. And then Job chapter 19, what is an unusual phrase, he says, after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. There's a strong sense all the way through the Old Testament that death will not win. Death will give way in the end to life, life that is truly life. And so Jesus arrives on the stage of history. The Son of God takes on flesh in order to become like us. He goes to the cross to bear the curse that we deserve for our rebellion. He takes it in our place. He stands in our place instead and bears the wrath of God that we don't have to. And then 3 days later, what happens? He's raised from death. Death couldn't hold him. He is the Son of life. And he accomplishes salvation and everlasting life for all who are connected to him by faith. Friends, if you have put your faith in Jesus Christ, you have eternal life. That's not just life that goes on for a very long time. It is a quality of life, life that is truly life. If you trust Christ, that is yours. That is the promise of the gospel. That is the good news of the Christian faith. And Paul's greeting, look at verse 2, it roots all of this, verse 2, in grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. All of this life is a gift. It's a gift. You don't have to do anything to earn it or obtain it. You can't do anything to earn it or obtain it. And so whatever you might face in life, whether it's sickness, whether it's loss or sadness, whether it is rejection, whether it is persecution, simply because you name the name of Christ, because you say, I'm a Christian and I want to follow Christ. Whether it's your physical death, in Christ there is life. It is undeserved, but it is freely given. And Paul connects his whole apostleship to this theme. His whole apostleship is connected to the heartbeat of what God has done through human history to bring light where there was darkness and life where there was death. That was the heart of his preaching. Look at verse 10, just below the reading we had. He talks about the grace that is given us in Christ, which now has been manifested through the appearing of our Savior Christ Jesus, who did what? He abolished death. He crushed death to death. And he brought life and immortality to light through the gospel, for which I was appointed a preacher, apostle, and a teacher, says Paul. Saying, that's the heartbeat of my ministry, Timothy, and it has to be the heartbeat of your preaching as well, because this is good news. It is the only good news for a world under God's judgment. And friends, it's the only answer to our biggest problem. One out of one dies, and only this gospel of life that is in Christ Jesus, the promise of eternal life in Christ, can do anything about that. And Paul is saying, remember, Timothy, you have the message of life. And the same is true for each of us. The question is, do you believe it? Do you believe this? Have you received this life for yourself? Some of you might need to do that this morning. You might need to, well, you do need to turn from your self-government. That is the essence of sin, setting us up, ourselves up against God and His world, governing ourselves, saying, no, God, I'm going to live my life on my terms, my way. Repentance means turning from that. Turning from that and turning to Christ, putting your faith in Him, the one who has won life and salvation for all who trust Him. Look at the empty cross and the empty tomb. That is a reminder. That is the guarantee that life can be yours in Christ. Will you trust Him? Will you trust Him? That's what it means to be a Christian, nothing else. If you haven't received it for yourself, friends, can you not delay? Don't leave here this morning without getting right with Him. Turn to Christ now. And as the people of God, do you believe that in a hostile world we have the promise of life for those who are desperately looking for it but looking in all the wrong places? Do you believe that? Do you believe that this is the only hope that we have for the world? And will you then tell others about it? Yes, they may increasingly make your life difficult, but you're not in prison yet. The government aren't knocking your door ready to imprison you just yet for telling people that you have a message of good news about life in Christ Jesus. They're not doing it yet. And as long as that's the case, keep going. Keep trying to show your friends, show your colleagues, show your family the way to this life. So Paul's first encouragement is a reminder of the life-giving reality of Christ's gospel. And secondly, he highlights, second reality he points to is Timothy's faith. Timothy's faith, verses 3 to 5. Paul shares the heart of his prayers. I thank God, whom I serve, verse 3, as did my ancestors, with a clear conscience, as I remember you constantly in my prayers, night and day. As I remember your tears, I long to see you that I may be filled with joy. I'm reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now, I am sure, dwells in you as well. Paul connects his ministry to his Jewish heritage, those who have gone before him, Abraham, Moses, David, those who believed God and trusted in his promise of life. And he serves with a clear conscience, he says. He's in prison. The implication is he's done something wrong. He says, no, my conscience is clear. I'm here for the gospel. And while he remembers Timothy's tears, maybe tears because Timothy knows that his mentor, his father in the faith, there's a good chance he won't see him again. His tears because of fear and anxiety that he feels at having to carry on this great work after the apostolic era. And Paul reminds Timothy that he stands in a similar line of faithfulness. As he faces the daunting prospect of bringing the apostolic gospel to a new generation, as his mentor, as the ones who went before them are dying out, and it's now him who has to step up. And doing it just at the very point that the church decided it didn't want it, and the culture decided to try and eliminate it. Timothy is reminded that he possesses the mark of true, persevering faith. He is the real deal. And he has all that he needs, Paul says, for whatever lies ahead. There are plenty of fakes around Ephesus, plenty who have a form of godliness but deny its power, he will say later in the letter. So Paul is grateful to God for the sincere faith he sees in Timothy. He's saying, listen, my faith has a legacy with those who have trusted God before me, and so does yours. I stand on the shoulders of those who have gone before, and so do you. In your case, Timothy, it's your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice. They've been converted from Judaism. Acts 16 tells us that Timothy's father was a Greek and was presumably not converted to Christianity. But these great women have taught him the gospel from his infancy. Point is, before Timothy was ever a leader, before he was ever a believer in the Lord Jesus, in the background are Lois and Eunice praying for him and teaching him God's word. I assume I don't need to say this in a Presbyterian church, but do not despise the privilege of a godly family. As someone who didn't have one, I want to say to those of you who are younger, it is an unspeakable kindness of the Lord that you are growing up where the Bible is at the heart of family life, where your parents model godly living to you, and where they pray for you, and they raise you in the church. It is a great privilege. You don't know, and you may never know, what chaos their prayers are keeping you from. I know for some of you, perhaps this experience of growing up in the church wasn't healthy, and there's baggage associated with your memory of that. But that lack of health wasn't because the gospel was there. It was because of how it was handled. Parents, those of you who are parents, let me remind you, raise your children in the Lord. If you don't self-consciously do that, if you don't self-consciously train them in the gospel, they will be trained in something else. There is no neutrality in the world. The culture is a teacher. It's always teaching them. Their peers are always teaching them. The influences that they engage with all the time are teaching them. Make sure that you're getting in at ground level and teaching them about Christ. Pray for them. Pray with them every day. Give your children the tools by which they can make your faith their own. And fathers, let me exhort you to take the lead in this. It's your responsibility to make sure it's happening. Maybe not that you do it every day, but you're overseeing that it's happening. And ladies, if there's no father around, if there's no father around because he's not a Christian or he's not present in your life, don't panic. Don't panic. Look at this story. Think about this. God heard the prayers of a godly granny. He used the spiritual leadership of a godly mother to raise up the great Pastor Timothy. What might he do with your prayers? What might he do with your Bible teaching? Don't despair. You might pray up the next Timothy. Who knows? So Paul sees the fruit of these two women's ministry in the life of Timothy, and he gives thanks to God. And he tells Timothy that he gives thanks in order that Timothy would be encouraged that his faith is the real deal, that he is a genuine believer, that he has the Spirit living in him, that he has a perfect foundation for whatever will lie ahead. And then flowing from this thanksgiving, Paul gives his first instruction of the letter. On the foundation of faith that he's saying Timothy has, he must put his gifts to use. And so the third reality that should encourage Timothy is this: it's God's gift. Christ's gospel, Timothy's faith, thirdly, God's gift. Verse 6, for this reason I remind you, because you are the real deal as a believer, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power and of love and self-control. Yes, Timothy's a genuine believer, but there's work to be done. There's work to be done, Timothy. And so you must put your gifts to use in order that this work would be done. Put the gifts that God has given to use. Now, the nature of the gift isn't specified here, but later on in chapter 4, Paul ties it to preaching. And so we can assume that this is what he has in mind. He reminds him of his commissioning by the apostle when hands were laid on him to publicly affirm him in his ministry. The gift came from God, but it was recognized at his ordination. Paul's hands didn't confer the gift, but they were the means by which the gift was affirmed by others. The way it works is that there are qualified people who put hands of affirmation on the one who's being set apart for the work, and they do it in the public context of others who affirm and agree, and that is to assure the one who is being set apart for this task that this is God's call for them. And the first thing we need to see with that is God gives his church what they need. Whatever the culture is doing, however hostile the culture is, God gifts pastors to enable them to shepherd the flock. God will not leave a faithful church without gifted leaders. We also need to see that Paul tells Timothy to put those gifts to work. That is, he's saying, get in your study, wrestle with the scriptures, pray for the Lord's help and insight, and preach the word. That's what fanning your gifts into flame looks like as a pastor. God gives the gifts. God determines the effectiveness of the gifts, but that doesn't mean that the person with the gifts coasts along. But the minister must keep fanning these gifts into flame. However long he goes on, he must keep doing it. I don't want to say this to embarrass him in any way. Liam referred earlier to the fact that I interned with him many, many years ago. And during that time, there was a trainee scheme for young people investigating pastoral ministry that developed in the life of the church. And we had afternoons where Liam would sit with us, and we would have our Bibles open, and we would be working on a passage of Scripture to see how we would break it up and preach it and apply it and all that kind of thing. It was you might call, a preaching workshop. And one of the things that struck us trainees was that Liam had this ability that he could almost exegete a passage in his sleep. He could just look at it and as it were, it just unfolded in his hands. Incredible giftedness, very insightful on the text. And then on Sundays, we would sit and hear him preach and wonder how we could ever be preachers. Here was a man that was gifted beyond what we ever imagined would ever be true of us. Now, that was almost 20 years ago. And the reason I tell you that is because I'm struck in my interaction with Liam, when we're in touch pretty regularly when I talk to him, I'm struck by how he continues to work hard to fan into flame the gift that the Lord has given him. He sees the significance of wanting to feed you faithfully every Lord's day, and he keeps doing what Paul calls Timothy to do here. Now, Paul tells him to do this because the Spirit of God, now that verse should be capitalized. God gave us a spirit, not of fear, but of power. I think it should be capitalized because he's referring to the work of the Holy Spirit. He talks about it in verse 14 as the work of the Spirit who gifts. And he says he is the Spirit of power and love and self-control. When it comes to Timothy putting his gifts to use, fanning them into flame, it is the Spirit who gives the power to do the work of preaching and teaching. If anything of lasting effect in the lives of Timothy's hearers, and so it is in the lives of anyone today, anything of lasting effect can only come by the Spirit's power. It is the Spirit who grants the kind of love that the minister needs, love for the Savior, love for the Savior's people that will keep him going, even when those people wander away into myths as they were doing in Timothy's day. And it is the Spirit, the Holy Spirit of God, who gives the pastor the self-control required to do the work. It takes self-control, I can assure you, it takes self-control to guard the time necessary to properly prepare sermons. It takes self-control not to take shortcuts and rely on your gifts. I see some of my contemporaries, I know they are incredibly gifted, way more gifted than me, but they're not putting the work in. It's easy to do that. It takes self-control to keep going back and being disciplined and working hard and not relying on your gifts. And it takes self-control to endure the kind of opposition that comes the way of a pastor and not give up. The Spirit of God animates every aspect of the pastor's role. The Spirit of God provides all that is necessary for faithful ministry. And so Paul tells Timothy, get on with it. It's God's Spirit who will enable you. You think about the way he has spoken here in these first few verses. It's clear the sovereign God of all the earth has gone ahead of Timothy to prepare and equip him for his ministry. And it's not just that he will equip you in the present, Timothy. We need to go all the way back. He saved Lois, his granny. He saved Eunice. He then answered those women's prayers for Timothy and saved Timothy. He then gifted Timothy for ministry. He then brought Timothy into the orbit of the great apostle to train and to mentor him. And now, the same Spirit who has done all that work for all those years to bring Timothy to this point has put him in Ephesus for such a time as this to carry the gospel into the post-apostolic era. With all of its challenges, with all of its difficulties, with all of the opposition that he's going to face, the Spirit has done this, Timothy. He's got you here. He won't leave you, so don't fear. And the same is true for every minister and every church since then. God has sovereignly led all of us, wherever you've come from this morning, wherever you live and move and have your being, the sovereign God of all the earth, by his Spirit, has led you to this point. However you got here, it was the Spirit of God who has been your leader, and he is a spirit of power and of love and of self-control, and so you don't need to fear. You don't need to fear. Whatever the culture is doing, you don't need to fear, because God is with you. But you do need to depend on him. That's what we must do, because he is the one who is at work in all of this. We need to plead with him to work. We need to plead with him to make our gospel efforts fruitful, to save people, to build his church, to advance the gospel here in Philadelphia and further afield. We need to cry out to him, oh Lord, do this, and grant to us this faith-fueled courage that you call us to here, that we would fearlessly press on full of confident hope. That's what we need, so let's plead with him that he would do that. Let's pray together. Our God and our Father, we praise you for the promise of life that is in Christ Jesus. We marvel at the grace and the mercy that you've shown us in saving us. We thank you that it is you that creates faith in us, and that in giving us saving faith, you give us the resources we need to persevere in a hostile culture. We thank you that you gift your church, and we pray that you would help us to recognize, to know afresh this morning, that the Spirit of God who lives in us by faith enables us. He animates our lives. And so help us, we pray, to press on. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.